Catch a vibe with Big Hass, only on Pulse. Pulse 95.
And we are going to say Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Peace, love, and blessings. And welcome to another week and another, of course, episode of Catch a Vibe, Pulse's first and only music dedicated radio show. In it, we talk to, you know, obviously musicians, singers, songwriters, poets, anybody with a creative mind. And I want to shout out all the musicians and the singers and the artists, everybody that came through. A big, big, big round of applause to everybody. It's been a beautiful journey, somehow rejuvenating myself through all the interviews and all the episodes that we've done. All the episodes, by the way, are available on YouTube and SoundCloud and streaming platforms. They're there. It's a show that is very dear to my heart. Shout out to Pulse 95 Radio for giving me this platform. Saturday and Sunday from 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. Sometimes we go over to 10, 15, 20 p.m. because, you know, I'm telling you, sometimes the, you know, the guests are just incredible. And speaking about incredible, let's do it. Tonight's guest is the first time we meet. And I gotta start with this method that I always say, but sometimes in the middle of the episode, but I'll say it here in the beginning. There's an old Bedouin saying that says, "In the insan alladhi la athara lahu, la hayata lahu." A human being with no impact has no life. And this human right here was able to impact me personally and many others, of course. But I'm talking about my personal connection with her in a crazy way. And this is what I was talking about, impact. When we talk about why are we here on this earth? What for? And felt using her words and her, you know, the way she writes and her poetry. That's how I got connected with her. And then I found out she's an incredible actress, a writer, a filmmaker, you know, and obviously putting our voices as Arabs, you know, specifically to the world. She's a human being that believes in elevating our voices. And this is such a honorable way of thinking. I'm telling you, I'm so honored and really, really happy to have the one, the only Saja Kilani right here in the studio. We're going to say Assalamu alaikum, Saja.
Hello, Assalamu alaikum.
How you doing?
Thank you so much for the beautiful introduction.
Oh, I tried it.
And thank you for having me today.
Oh, bless you, my sister. I swear to God. Of course, Palestinian, Jordanian, Canadian. You know, incredible. Mashallah alayki. I got to start with the beginning of Saja. How did you, like I said, you're a mashallah, a writer, an actress, a filmmaker, how, and a poet. How did you, where did the spark of creativity start with Saja, and what was the first love?
So I've always been interested in acting.
Okay.
And I was in theater first before anything else.
Okay.
And it was honestly one play production that I was part of that sparked this art for me. Mm. And it was a Palestinian play called Tales of a City by the Sea.
Yeah.
By Samah Sabawi.
Oh,
the
man.
Talented Samah Sabawi.
Yeah, yeah.
And when I saw the response from the audience and how it impacted them, and they weren't necessarily Palestinians, they were people from all over the world, and I saw how much I saw the power of art firsthand, and I realized that I could do so, like, we can do so much with it.
Yeah.
Words are so powerful.
Correct.
And they should not be underestimated. And so that is when I decided to go on this journey of filmmaking, and I found my love for writing, and then leaned into poetry.
Wow.
And so on.
That's incredible. How did the Tales of City by the Sea come about?
So it was a production by a friend of mine who was a director at the time. She was casting people for the play.
Okay.
And so she told me about it. She told me you should come audition. It's a really cool story. And so I did, and I fell in love with the script.
Nice.
Fell in love with storytelling. Mm. And I learned a lot from the writer herself.
Ya Allah.
And so honestly, that was just, to this day, I've done a couple of roles after that, but to this day, that one role has impacted me so much enough to be here today. So.
SubhanAllah. Wow, amazing. When it comes to, you know, the poetry, I know that this is Philistine, for example. How did that also come about? Because again, as a writer, as an actress, as a, you know, theater, filmmaker, how did poetry find its way with Saja?
It all stems from an emotion
at the
moment.
Okay.
Every time I feel something, I turn to my notes app and I write it down. If I feel something today, I'm probably going to go to my notes app and write
it
down.
Let's go. Bless.
And so at the time, This Is Palestine stemmed from during Sheikh Jarrah and what was happening at the time.
Yeah.
Still to this day. And so it was like self-therapy for me. Just to write things down, and then I noticed I developed this rhythm for rhyming, and I enjoyed it a lot, and so I explored it more. And even when I was in film school, I kind of met up with my writing instructor, and we kind of went through certain things, and I realized, okay, maybe this is something that I enjoy doing, and so I gave it more time.
So again, it's that first time I meet you, but there's two things I noticed. There's the definitely peace within. This is really amazing. And also, so far, you have not forced anything towards the talents that you're in, which a lot of people sometimes force, for example, to, if they do English music, they want to force Arabic. With you so far, it feels like everything kind of connected and fell into place. When you look back at so far your career, what would you say that is an evolution of Saja Kilani?
Honestly,
so far,
persisting and committing in this industry, I think, has been the strongest thing. Looking back, I'm so happy that with all the challenges that came and all the roadblocks that naturally and inevitably happened, I maintained here, and I still haven't reached what I want to reach. Of course, I'm so ambitious, and I have so much that I want to accomplish. But just being here and persisting in an unconventional route, so to speak, is probably my biggest accomplishment.
Is it you moved to Toronto when you were like 15?
Yes.
Okay. So a couple of things here before we take a short break. How is it like over there? Like, you know, like in terms of, how do I say this? Because I feel that people like you are so important, Saja, because you are inside the belly of the beast in a way. Because there's a lot of things that are wrong, that are said about us from there. And I've been very vocal about this. For the longest period of time, our voice has not been us. Our story is not by us.
Mm-hmm.
Told by us.
Yes.
For us, not by us. How is it like over there when it comes to, like, you know, our voices, our, you know, culture, you know, everything.
It's exactly what you just said. When you go there, you see it firsthand even more.
Yes,
you see how people are talking about you versus you mentioned, you know, and it's never true.
Yeah.
There's so many stereotypes.
Yeah.
And the difference between the West and the East, which fascinates many, is honestly the creative freedom. Yes, Canada has a boundless amount of creative expression and space. Yet this region, Jordan, is my personal experience, is rich with culture and tradition and stories. So honestly, this is, even when I was there, the work I did in Canada always traced back to my Arabic roots because there's a lot to say about us.
And fam, Allah yahmiki for that. That's what I'm saying, because like you went there and you decided to speak also about us in a way. And again, I'm not shading anyone who goes there and decide not to speak, but I think it's really important. I love that. Was it difficult the first few years of being there?
Of course. I was very young, and I was with my family. We moved, my family moved together. Yeah. And it was culture shock in every aspect. every aspect. But I think I learned to adapt, but not to let go of who I am at the same time. Just to be able to communicate and maneuver in a space that you're not.
Okay, wait, that clap came late. It's not working, the thing. I'm sorry.
No worries.
No, but bless you. I love that.
I appreciate the clap. But yes, definitely. It helps you personally, individually, as a person. But I found myself, so I do owe it to Canada as well. I found myself as a Jordanian, Palestinian, Canadian being there. Mm-hmm. And then it motivated me to come back here and share the knowledge that I've gained there.
Wow. We're definitely going to talk about that. But one of the cool things is when you speak about art and obviously, resistance. How important for you is that. And the question I think that maybe a lot of people want to even know the yes or no is, does it really make an impact?
Yes, for sure. Art is resistance, in my opinion. And I saw there's responsibility in knowing that your art can impact other people. And I only found that out when I started to publicly share my work. And I got feedback from people saying, whether that be I helped someone with an insecurity, personal insecurity, or I helped someone feel a certain way during a time that we are currently feeling right now.
100%.
So seeing that and just reading about all these people that I do not even know. And I wrote, even when I write something that's personal to me, somewhere along the lines, something resonates with someone. So it's honestly... It starts as self-healing, but it ends up healing others, which makes it an even bigger statement.
Yeah, that's another round of applause right there. I love that. Okay, we're going to take a very, very short break. I just want to say, if you're watching on YouTube, by the way, there's a camera right here. And this is it's a beautiful gift by my sister, of course, Saja, right here. She gave me that gift. Thank you so much.
Of course.
And I just want to, let's come up with a name for it. I mean, you're the creative one right here.
Oh, no. You put me on the spot.
Let's come up with a name.
A name.
Yeah. What do you think?
What do I think?
Yeah. We'll think about it.
All right.
Let's think about it in the break.
Thank you.
Yeah, let's do that. But yeah, thank you so much. Such a beautiful, very thoughtful. And part of what I do, obviously, we're an FM radio. We've got to play a record right now for the people listening in their cars or wherever they're listening. What song can I play right now?
Well, let's give a shout out to Saint Laurent because I just wrote a short poem for the song. It's called Dira.
Beautiful record, of course. This is a Saint Laurent MC Abdul record. Beautiful record. And Saja right here had the first, obviously, can we talk a little bit about this? How did this happen? Saint Laurent obviously hit you up and said what? Write me something about this?
Yes, he hit me up a week, almost 10 days before the song.
Okay.
And he said, I want you to write like an intro, a poem, but I want it in Arabic. And my work has been in English. But I got excited. He sent me the music video and I saw it. And it just sparked this idea to come up with this short excerpt of just what I envisioned the summary of the music video would be as a starter. And that was it. We spoke like for 2 days, sent it to him.
That's crazy. And what was his reaction? Like his immediate reaction?
He loved it. He definitely told me, he sent me a voice note saying, you know, everyone that has listened to it cried, which honestly was it was great to hear.
It is such a, like it's straight to the point too. There is sweetness in it. There is nostalgia in it. And there is power in it. It's all these things. And like three lines, like how'd you fit that in?
Because it's exactly what it means for me when you tell me, you know, tell me about your history. I think about my grandparents' memories. And then I also think about the young ones and how resistant they are. It just made sense.
It's a beautiful record. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to play this record right here. Dira Saint Laurent, MC Abdul. Shout out to Khalid on the production as well. And has, of course, Saja Kilani's, obviously, words in the beginning. Keep it locked. Do not go anywhere. It's Pulse 95 Radio with me, Big Hass, with a special guest in the building, the incredible Saja Kilani.
Catch a vibe with Big Hass, only on Pulse. Pulse 95.
Only on Pulse 95 Radio, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back again. Catch a vibe every Saturday and Sunday from 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. I have a special guest in the building, of course, Saja Kilani, actress, writer, a filmmaker, a poet, an incredible human being, somebody obviously that, you know, moved to Canada when she was young, and now she's making that comeback. And Saja, thank you so much for your time. I truly appreciate it, really.
Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Saja, I think there's a couple of things that you said before the break that I kind of want to push on more, if you don't mind, which is like this sense of belonging to your culture. The reason why I say that, there's a lot of people that obviously, you know, come from this part of the world, but unfortunately, once they go to the West, they forget everything about where they came from. So my question to you is, where did that passion come from? Is it from family? Is it... And because I think that is the root of why you're doing what you're doing. There was a sense of belonging, and you loved your culture, in my opinion, in the right way. And I love that. I respect that. So I respect, of course, your family, the way they brought you up. That's how automatically I see it. But maybe you see it in a different way, if you know what I mean.
Yes. Honestly, being in Canada, what sparked this for me was when, in for example, acting class, we'd be sitting and each person had some actor that they looked up to. And it always was an actor from their country, an actor from, you know, their people.
Yeah.
And I liked how prideful they were when they said that. And almost they were the reason that brought them into this industry. And so I looked back at the time, this was when I was 15.
Yeah, yeah.
And there weren't a lot of Arab actors.
Mm.
And I said to myself, you know, I would love to be sitting here and saying a name of someone that looks like me and comes from where I come from.
Got you.
And I decided, you know, I want to be this person. And whether that be through acting, writing, filmmaking, whatnot, I want to help girls, guys,
yeah.
anyone who's into this industry as a new artist to say, okay, there is someone out there that does look like me. And that's kind of where I decided I want to amplify our sense of belonging.
Wow, love that. When you're working on like you're part of either a film or a short film, we're going to talk about that in a bit, or a play, or what attracts you in a script?
Storytelling. I am inspired by stories that are based on true events because to me, filmmaking is far more than just entertainment. It's
Facts.
Educational.
Facts.
And when you look at, there's a lot of stories that go unnoticed or voices that are often censored. And those are the ones that I'm most interested about. So if you give me a short film about something that truly happened to someone, whether it's something that I resonate with or I don't, I love to be part of this project because it is giving voice to the voiceless.
Wow. It's like first time I meet her, but I'm a fan right now already. I've already been a fan. But, you know, you just remind me of something. I'll tell you a quick story about somebody I met. His name is Odyssey. He's an amazing rapper, Sudanese-American. When I met him, he kind of gave me a nickname. And that nickname kind of stuck with me for a while. I don't think I've shared this story on live radio before. Some people know it. So he called me the Lighthouse. And I felt that's an interesting, obviously, nickname. I said, why? He's like, because sometimes people only look for the lighthouse when they're actually in trouble. Right?
Wow.
Or to the show, you know?
Yes.
Which happens, what happens with me always, because sometimes I don't get credit enough or what I do. And you're lighting. You're just showing the way to the shore. You just want people to be, you know? And while you're talking, that nickname kind of like, this girl, like, you're inspired. What you want to inspire people to speak also their truth. And what you said about it doesn't matter about how famous it is or not. It just have to be obviously true from within. Did you see that coming before when you like, did your life, what sort of kind of, I would say, especially when you moved to Canada, what sort of challenges you were faced with in terms of moving as a newcomer?
From every aspect, there's challenges of different culture, different language, different everything. Even I had no friends when I first moved. I didn't know anyone, and so pushing yourself to put yourself out there. But I noticed something about us humans is that we relate to authenticity more than we relate to anything else.
Fact.
And right now we live in a social media world where a lot of things that you see online are not true. There's a lot of fake news, a lot of editing.
Yeah.
So what you see is not really what's within. And so people like to relate to things that are truthful to oneself because that is how they feel internally. Because social media is what you feed externally.
Yeah.
When we speak to each other, this is how we feed internally.
Fact.
And that's how we relate to one another. And so when you create work that is truthfully to you, that's speaking from internally rather than externally, that's when you realize, okay, this is I've impacted certain people. And it doesn't have to be anything extravagant. Like, funny enough, the poems that I recorded from my phone were the ones that went viral and reached a lot of people. And the ones that I actually worked on and had a big production. I did get great feedback, but nothing compared to the ones that were just, you know, random shots taken at home. And that's because people relate to this idea of just being who you are.
Being who you are. I guess what I'm trying to say earlier is that the background that you're in, helped obviously be the person that you are.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, again, shout out to your family. How does the family feel about all of this? Where do they stand?
My family is so supportive.
Oh, alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah, yes.
Oh, shout out to them.
My parents are so, so, so supportive. Shout out to Mama and Baba.
Shout out to them.
Salih and Duna.
Ahlan wa sahlan.
Yes, they're amazing. My siblings are my backbone. And having that support definitely makes it a lot easier.
Mm.
It makes me feel comfortable with my art. I know that no matter what happens, I'll always have their back.
Mm.
And yes, it's obviously mutual.
yeah, no, 100%. I agree. I see you. You recently, when did you post Our Women?
Our Women, I think 2 weeks ago now.
Okay. So obviously there was this interviewer, right? And we all know the story. But your caption was like, this shocked you to your core and you had to react.
Yes.
Can you take me through the first few kind of moments when you saw the interview and how she was saying, and what was the feeling that you had on?
Well, as a lot of viral videos, it reached the family group chat.
Oh, wow.
And that was the first time I saw it. Mm. Coincidentally, I was on the chat and I think my dad sent it. I'm not sure who exactly. And I remember when I watched it, I felt this sort of resentment, and I didn't like that. I felt that it was not a good feeling. I can tell you that. And I saw how I read the comments.
Yes.
I read how people were just also very angry,
angry.
And it was this communal feeling, you know.
Facts.
And I always, as always, I turned to my notes app and I started writing things.
Oh, wait, right away?
Right away.
Right away.
Right away. Because I was already on my phone. I was looking at the family group chat. So I just switched to the notes app. And I just started, I didn't write the poem.
Yeah.
I just wrote how I felt at the time.
Yeah.
And then I decided to revisit it when I give during the week a couple of hours of just me sitting and writing down poetry. And so I went to my notes app and I remembered how I felt. And I it just felt so truthful. I wrote down certain things.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know what? I want to reply to her, but in poetry.
Yes.
As if I'm speaking to her.
Yes.
But on behalf of everyone that is angry, and I hope I can do us all justice.
Ya Allah, you did us more than justice. Yeah, were you, sorry with the question, were you shocked with the feedback, with how it turned out to be?
Oh, yes, I mean.
When you posted it.
I hope that, enough people would watch it and be like, okay, thankfully, I hope she reads it. I hope she watches it. But
she watched it, all right.
But it was far beyond her watching it,
of course,
because I realized, and even in the poem, I started talking, and this is kind of how I navigate through this entire thing, is that we do not need to talk about anyone else. It's not synonymous. If we just stick to how we are, our history, our power, our strength, our stories, our memories, it's more than enough.
More than enough.
It's factual. It's there.
Yes.
It's evident.
Yeah.
And if you just keep writing and talking about it and filming it, you keep it alive.
So there was this part. I'm watching this, right? Our Women. By the way, you guys should definitely go watch it. I want to see if we can play a little bit of it in the next segment. But when I was watching it, there was one part you flipped. You said that one line in Arabic. It's like, whoa. Hey, I was like, what? I was like, boom. And then towards the end, you started mentioning names. And I was like, at that point, khalas, I'm like, you're really educating. Like, I swear to God, I was like, what? This is like the perfect. And I remember me and my one and only, my wife, we were watching. And I was like, wow, the way you replied, I would say, the way you kind of, it was so justice and right in the best way possible. Because all of us, Saja was feeling angry. And sometimes anger is not the right way to express.
Of course.
And that's why it's like fashat. It was like, I don't know what fashat is in English. Like it was like a. So thank you.
Like a moment of relief.
Big time. Thank you. Like seriously,
you.
What a. I mean, but did the feedback shock you?
Yes, very much so. And I noticed something about myself too. Is I actually shot it at my friend's house, Zain. She helped me with
what?
With it. Yes.
Oh, no way.
We did two
Shout
takes.
Out to Zen. No way.
I tried to be as authentic as possible. The first one, there was a lot of noise in the background,
yeah,
and so we did it again.
Yeah.
But I noticed that I didn't use my body language.
Okay.
I was just speaking, and I think it because it came from here. It came from the core that was angry.
Mm.
And I was speaking from inside. And when I watched the video, I was like, damn, I'm not moving at all. Like, I'm not even moving my hands. I'm not doing anything.
Yeah, no.
But it was that feeling that had to be, like you said, fishghil.
Yeah. Yeah,
it had to be released.
But see, that takes a lot. Like, for me, it was like, so a lot of people that were mad at this, and there was they didn't know how to express. And the best way, you did it, you did it justice. Like, thank you again. Like, seriously.
Thank you,
seriously. Wow. Yeah, amazing. We want to take a short break, but before that, we kind of found out a name for this camel. If
yes.
you're tuning in, there's an update camel name hashtag. What's the name?
So I'm inspired by your sweater, Osaka.
Osaka. Yeah.
And yeah, so I saw that name and I saw the camel next to it. I was like,
listen, I'm telling you, it makes sense.
Let's do that.
Osaka. 4215, if you agree with that name. We're calling it Osaka. Beautiful name, by the way. I like it. I think it makes so much sense.
My dream is to go to Japan.
Yo, me too.
Yes.
It's definitely one of the, you know, on the bucket list. So what song can we play right now?
Well, since we're talking about Japan, let's play Big in Japan by Ash.
Whoa.
Featuring Amelie Martinez.
Yes. She came ready. I'm telling you, that's amazing. We're definitely going to play that. Keep it locked right here, ladies and gentlemen. Pulse 95 Radio. We will be right back.
Catch a vibe with Big Hass. Only on Pulse. Pulse 95.
Only on Pulse 95 Radio. Big Hass right here. Catch a vibe. Obviously, special guest in the building. Saja Kilani, an actress, writer, a filmmaker, a poet. Saja, if I play you this record...
يمام ويلي الهوى يمام ويلي ضرب الخانة جر ولا حكم هذا البي.
And of course it's Zen with her mom. Ya Allah. Such a beautiful, beautiful record that we play right here on the show. What's the when this obviously came out? What's the bless you? Ya Allah, yeah. Shout out to Zen and her mom, of course, and shout out to Palestine. And the reason why I want to play this is because obviously when you hear this, especially at these times right now that we're going through, I don't even know where to start, but what's the if people are listening to us right now, Saja, and they don't know how to, you know, react what's the sentiment when it comes to, obviously we talked about it, using your art to obviously to describe what's going on? Because I think you said something interesting. You said obviously it's a duty, and Nina Simone said the same thing. It's a duty for any artist to reflect the time that they live in. Like, it's a duty. She used the word duty.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel the same. So I guess my question in here, when you hear, like, you know, songs like that, when you hear, like, obviously, you know, brothers and sisters talking about, you know, what's going on in a way, or addressing it in a way and highlighting it, giving awareness more. What's the first thing that come to your mind as Saja?
Well, first of all, shout out to my best friend Zain and Auntie Maysoon. I love this cover.
Me too, yeah.
As an artist, I do agree, of course, with the legendary Nina Simone. It is your duty. And when I think of what I can do is using my words. And like I said before, your words are so powerful.
They are.
They get you in leadership positions and in power and whatever it is. And so it's very important for you to use that to keep our stories alive. I do believe in what our grandparents gave us. It's like the torch. I call them the seeds, and we're the plants. And so as plants, we need to flourish, and we need to share their stories and their memories. And my direct connection to my land and my history is that. It's the stories and the memories. And so my duty is to keep sharing that, because I have never been there, but I feel like I have, just because of everything I've heard. Mm. And it's my right to share that as well to the next generation and the one coming.
I love that you said that. We live in a world where, especially right now, that just like actually 2-3 days ago, a week ago, there was this hamla or campaign called Key for Palestine happened in Sharjah, right here. Mm-hmm. And basically, just to give obviously awareness and a little bit of what the brothers and sisters in Gaza are going through. What I'm trying to say is that sometimes you give that awareness, you shout, and still the world does not, like, obviously, you know, listen or act. How does that make you feel as a creative here in this case? Like, because you're pouring your heart out in your art and in a way to make that impact. And when you don't see that impact, does that, like, put you down a little bit?
No, it motivates me more, honestly. And I'm not just saying that because I'm on here. And seriously, if my message is not being portrayed in a manner
captured,
that I want
correct.
It to capture, correctly, it makes me, okay, this is not working, let's do it this way.
Yes,
okay, this is not working, let's do it this
way. Try another way.
Try another way.
Mm.
There's always multiple different ways, and all you can do is just try.
Yeah, see, that's the resilience, especially when we talk about Palestine. It's like you guys, it's like it gets in, I mean, I don't even like to inspiring. The other day, and I mentioned this, I know a couple of people in Gaza, and I said, what can we do? And you know what they said to me? They said, you are doing by just talking. That made me feel so guilty, I would say. And that made me feel so, like, what do you mean? Just keep talking. We see you. I'm like, what do you mean you see? What?
Yes.
And I'm like, and they were like, this is enough. I'm like, la. And I'm like, subhanAllah, what God has instilled in the people of Palestine is something that, saraha, I don't know, like, the amount of faith, the amount of this resilience, I haven't, like, you know.
The way I look at it, it's as if you're writing something and someone has on a chalkboard and someone is erasing it, but you keep writing and they keep erasing it and you keep writing. This is exactly what it is.
Yeah.
When someone is trying to erase something, an entire culture, if you just keep talking about it, that's just one step ahead.
Ya Allah.
And I think about the press on the front line right now.
Yeah.
And if they are risking their lives just to document something for you, the least you can do as someone here is to share that and
share
to also
that.
Talk about it.
Talk about it. And keep talking about it. Well, thank you so much for sharing that. With you, Saja, right now, how do you deal with what's going on? Like, personally, how do you process, like, what's going on? All the visuals that we've seen as humans right now, like, everything that you've seen and you know, the stories. Inti, how do you deal with it?
I resort to what I can, which is my art.
Okay.
Whether that be write short films or write poetry.
Mm.
But I try to also educate a lot of people. I mean, I have a lot of friends in the West, those that aren't necessarily educated enough about what's currently happening, and I try to share that as much as possible. Thankfully, my target audience on my social media, which shocked me the other day, my top countries are US, UK, Canada, and then Jordan.
Those are the people.
Yes.
We need those.
And it could be the Arabs in those countries.
Yeah.
but you never know. So
yeah.
There's also that responsibility
of
that these people are following you to try to see what. It's a lot of it's a big big duty, but also try to understand that the least I could do is just share what I know and what I'm currently learning consistently.
Mm.
And that's kind of how I'm trying to go about it. I'm trying to not let it get to me. Trying to persist, as I said before.
Yeah, you said that. Your thesis. What short film? What's your emergency? Can we talk a little bit about that? You know, obviously you were talking, you know, domestic, you know, violence and showcasing, you know, your versatility as a filmmaker. But can we talk a little bit about that? I think it's important for people to know as a thesis, why did you choose even, you know, that to speak about? And tell me a little bit about.
So What's Your Emergency is a short film that I wrote when I was in film school.
Mm.
And I had a conversation.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah.
Sorry, grammar.
No.
God sent me here. But I had a conversation with someone who had an experience with domestic violence.
Okay.
And that conversation kind of sparked this idea. And this person wasn't someone who you would imagine as this victimized individual.
Get you.
Very strong, powerful person that you might not think would be going through something like this. And it gave me this idea of you never know what someone is going through, regardless of what is shown externally. And that's kind of what's your emergency. That's kind of the summary of this this short film. And it also, I was inspired by this TikTok video that I found on how someone escaped. Someone was held hostage and they called 911 but pretended they're ordering a pizza.
No way.
It went viral at the time. And it was kind of like their way out. And so I used that also in What's Your Emergency to try to incorporate. But sometimes also leaving a certain situation could be harder than staying. Because you never know what might come after that. And so that's also another idea that the short film tackles. I have not released it publicly. I just shared it to the film festival in my school, Toronto Film Festival.
Yeah.
Film School.
Film
Festival
School.
Of
yeah.
Films
yeah.
is what it's called. And surprisingly well.
Oh, bless.
We got 4 nominations
and
2 wins.
Oh, that's amazing. That's amazing. But again, you know, it's just kind of listening to you right now and sparked something. Like, does it, as Saja, when you see the love that people are giving you on your poetry, does that take away? Because obviously you do a lot of things. You have a writer, an actress, the poet. How does that? How do they all fall in terms of where? Because I think maybe sometimes I feel that maybe people are gravitated towards that. For example, your poetry, and you know they forget that you do. For example, you're acting, you're writing. Do you think about that, or no? They all fall into the same space.
I think we live in a time where you can do multiple things.
Of course.
And. If one thing is doing better than the other, I try not to let it distract me from still doing and loving what I do
point.
Next.
Okay.
I mean, acting, I've just recently tapped into it professionally in Jordan. Mm. I just was in my first feature film.
You did?
Yes. It should be coming out next year.
Oh,
I don't
what?
Know if I can
Okay, amazing. Congrats. Okay.
But very ambiguously.
Okay.
I'm hoping to dip my toes more in that field because acting is where it all stemmed for me.
Yes.
It's my passion. I love storytelling and I love acting more so than anything. And poetry is just something that I found healing for myself.
Ya Allah.
So I feel like I'll always be doing, if people like poetry more than filmmaking, so be it. I'd love any certain feedback. But I try not to distract.
I love that you said that. I think that shows also, you know, kind of maturity in a way, because a lot of people might, they get distracted with that. And not only that, they maybe just follow what the trend is. And like, oh, okay, people are there. But I wanted to hear that your first passion is still there. And I think it's important because you can still impact, obviously, you know, through acting. What's the throughout all these years, what would you say is like that biggest challenge you faced throughout all this time? Is, you know,
I think it took me a while to truly digest that judgments are extensions of insecurities. I used to, as any teenager, would really care about what people had to say. And so I suppressed this passion of mine because I always wanted to be this. I wanted to be a lawyer beforehand, and I thought, you know, this is the stable, right career. And I'm very passionate politically. I'm very passionate in general. But this is kind of the route I wanted to take. But it was only until I found out how powerful my art can be and how every side little art thing that I did, how it grew. And I said, you know, why just really listen to people's opinions that usually have nothing to do with you and everything to do with them.
But can we talk a little bit about that? Like, I think what was it that, because I think a lot of people, especially the young people, go through that. How did you overcome that? Like, people's opinion, and because we talk about it, but really there's no.
Yes, I have an answer, actually. It's a physical attribute of mine. I have this skin condition called vitiligo.
Okay.
And I wrote a poem about it called My Vitiligo as well. But this was, to me, the biggest motivation to these roadblocks, because I cared for multiple years about what people thought about it enough to cover it with foundation every day. And I have it all over my body. I have it on my hands, my arms, my face, which is still there. And I used to cover it. And then I went to so many dermatologists and I did like tattoo to cover it as well. I tried everything you could think of. And I realized that once I made peace with it, I felt beautiful internally. And that to me was a lot more relieving than how people view me. And so I realized...
starts within you.
Exactly. And what people are saying, it's irrelevant to how you feel. And it's hard to say. I know it's a lot easier to say than to feel. But the minute you actually realize that, you notice that people are always going to have something to say.
Facts.
Whether you're doing great or you're not. people are always going to have something to say.
Yeah.
But you need to know that their opinion is their opinion, and it has everything to do with them and nothing to do with you. And just as long as you're authentic to yourself and your line of work, whatever that may be, as long as you are happy with what you're doing, you can flourish there.
And I think, ladies and gentlemen, if you're listening, like, you know, you definitely heard that before. You heard it from many people. But I think just what she said right now, like physically actually showing you what was it, I think that it was such a powerful example. I thank you so much for doing that. Like, seriously, wow. Where's my round of applause, bro? Wow. I'm just like, yeah, see, I'm inspired by that because we hear this, everybody. I say it all the time, be yourself and don't let anyone, but you just also showed it and proved and proved it that it starts really like from here, from within. And that's the answer. Like, seriously, there's no other way. Like, it starts from within.
Can I give you a round of applause?
No. You are the star. Well, bless you, my sister. You're amazing. Okay. We're obviously we're gonna take a short break, but I wanted to check with you right here. Obviously, if you want to play a certain record, please suggest one.
Yes, of course. I would like to play my favorite song, written by my best friend Zayn.
Oh wait, as a declaration, khalas, favorite song.
Palestinian Jordanian singer and songwriter, Anna Wayne.
Oh. That's your favorite?
That's my favorite.
Why? Yes. That's okay, we got to know why. Let's dissect it right now. Zen, if you're tuning in, you know? Why?
Something about the song, I don't know if it's the writing or... I think everything about it, honestly. Yeah. It just resonated with me a lot. Mm. And I saw this... not because I know her, but Anna Wayne just... reminds me of my journey, of where I am now and where she is as well. You know, having someone beside you in this industry is very important because, you know, you motivate each other, you understand, you relate to each other on a level that no one else can understand.
Correct.
And so seeing her journey and, you know, she's a singer, I'm an actor, and we're not necessarily in the same exact field, but we are, and it's synonymous.
Crazy.
And that song, I don't know, for some reason hits me like that, even though she wrote it from a different perspective.
Maybe, yeah.
But that's the beauty of art, is that there's multiple different versions.
Facts.
You relate to it in your own personal
100%,
way.
100%.
So yeah, that's,
I love
that's
that.
Why it's my favorite.
You picked a really a good one. You know, definitely we'll hear that by Zen, who, like I said, definitely one of our favorites right here. We're going to be right back. Do not go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen. Down to our last segment with Saja Kilani. And yeah, it's only going to get better, I'm telling you. Keep it locked, Pulse 95.
Catch a vibe with Big Hass, only on Pulse. Pulse 95.
Pulse 95 Radio, ladies and gentlemen. Obviously, Zed with Edward. Saja Kilani in the building. How proud are you of Zen?
I cannot put it in words.
It's a great record. So I think for me, seeing also this, you know, beautiful friendship and you know, sisterhood and all this, you know, between you guys, also inspiring to see your supporter. She supports you. It's beautiful. When you see someone like Zen, you know, kind of obviously go, like you said, with her path, does it also inspire you to continue in yours?
Of course. Of course. And that's what I hope to do as well.
Yeah. I know. I'm sure you do that. And I think it's really amazing. It's really amazing what, you know, like I'm talking about, like, you know, two, you know, Arab women with Zain and Saja right here, really doing just incredible things in terms of like each of them in their own different way. And you're able to, you know, do wonders at it. Saja, towards the end, really, it's been incredible. I was telling you off air, mashallah, you're talented in many things, and it feels like one interview is not enough. But I kind of want to go back to the poems, if you don't mind, like with No Honor in Honor Killing, and I Am receiving a lot of, obviously, there was a lot of, you know, attention and a lot of, you know, feedback on it. How do you choose what you talk about? And I know that comes in from within, but why do you think these two also connected with people?
Again, it stems from an emotion, mm-hmm. and I don't necessarily choose like I don't choose it as if it's content.
Okay.
That I'm writing something for the sake of writing. I write what I feel, and with I Am, for example, I noticed that we were adhering to the stereotype, mm-hmm. This portrayal of us as Arabs that mm-hmm. was not necessarily true, and I wanted to showcase the beauty. That is not, there aren't a lot of, you know, art created that shows you that at the time when I was writing it. It was very stereotypical, and it was a narration that did not resemble us.
Yes.
It didn't resonate to who I felt. Like if you were to ask me to describe myself as a Jordanian, that is not how I would have described myself. Mm. And so this is kind of, I was like, I need to write something that really speaks about us.
Yeah. But see, again, it feels like when we first obviously started chatting, is this something that is in your vision? You always want to represent us in the best way. If someone would say, what's the vision or what's the dream for Saja Kilani, what would it be now?
The dream.
Such a big word, I know.
Yes, but it's to put us in my, as a filmmaker, as an artist, for me, is to put us on screen and behind the screen. Because right now, like, authentically. Because right now, at least for the film industry, they're prioritizing what is called visible minorities. Mm. So if you adhere to this visible portrayal of what a person who is diverse would look like. But us Arabs, we come from different shapes and forms and skin colors. We do not look the same. Mm. And if you want to represent us authentically, you should not adhere to, for example, when someone thinks of an Arab, let's say, thinks to about a bearded man or whatever whatever image could pop up.
You're looking at a blue-eyed Saudi.
Exactly. You have blue eyes. Yeah. Zain has green eyes. My friend Maggie has blonde hair.
Shout out Maggie. I'm telling you.
Shout out Maggie for sure.
I hear you. I hear you. When you talk about, you know, kind of filmmaking, can we talk about the inspiration, like who inspires you from our region? I'm talking about who's someone that, you know, really like inspires you like that. If there's something that comes to your mind right now,
I think of honestly, I think of the artists that have not been put out there yet. My friends that I know that are so talented, but have not been given the opportunity to shed that light yet.
Can we mention like a couple of names? Is there anyone that we can? I don't want to put you on the spot.
there's a lot of names. There's a lot of names I could think of. There's Noor Siraj. Mm. There's I'm thinking of my friends Kalina Liang. I think of Steve Diouf. I think of Yusuf Mutawi. I think of a lot of people. You know, not just Jordanians and Palestinians. I think of people from all over. And when you put me on the spot, I'm sure I missed a lot of people.
No, bless. But no, I people understand, of course. I get it. I totally get it. But I think when we talk about, you know, what you said, putting people, you know, on and behind the camera, that I think that's powerful.
Because I worked on a commercial once where everyone, because I was an actor in it, and everyone on the screen came from different places around the world. All the crew members were from one place. And it was like, if you want to share this, if you want to have diversity within your work, have it both internally, externally.
100%. Since you're talking about that, how do we make this happen? Because I think it's a really big story, even as when you talk about the National Basketball Association, right? Which is the players are majorly, African-American, where the owners are white. So this discussion happens every now and then. There's, you know, so how do we, in your opinion, how do we destroy this, or what do we have to do?
Hire people in those positions.
Straight up.
Straight up. Hire them. It's like when you go on, it's like The Voice, right? You hear someone's voice, the audition.
Correct.
You know The Voice.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, of course.
So you hear without seeing what is behind behind the curtain.
Yeah.
And so even for these positions, hire people for their actual job and what they offer and their skill and besides what, you know. And usually it would be better to hire people that could relate to who is being represented.
That's it. That's it. I think that's truly important. Truly. Do you think we're far off from that? Like, given the fact that you're a little bit in the industry?
I think we have platforms right now to speak about certain things, and people are listening. You know, and sometimes they make it a trend. So if we happen to make this a trend, that would be lovely.
You know what? I hear you. It's interesting you say that. For example, I come from Saudi Arabia. There was always a an image about Saudi Arabia, like, you know, a certain image. Now, back in the day, there was a couple of people that did, obviously, some sort of a platform called Tifaz 11. I'm not sure if you... So I know these guys, and I know their stories, and look at them right now being really championed big time. But they worked so hard.
They're
in order.
They're doing great.
Yeah, big time. But they went through this struggle, and they were telling the stories of the actual things that's going on in Saudi, not what, you know... Like, not what you want to hear, but what's going on. So I think it takes a lot of, obviously, of a lot of, you just have to keep kind of fighting. And to all the names that you mentioned and all the names that you didn't mention, I really, really want them not to give up and always build your platform. If a platform is not, you know, getting you or supporting you, kind of build your own platform. And I think this is the, you know, this is the way. This is insane. Like, I don't know. It's been crazy. We're a bit even over time. But I gotta just highlight a couple of things, if you don't mind. We wanna. This is the our women. One second.
Themselves medicine and set up medical teams. They performed critical surgeries under apartheid regimes and gave birth at checkpoints as soldiers looked in between. Our women learned to teach in abandoned spaces. They built their own schools, wrote their own rules for the sake of their own children's education. Our women learned to cook.
Saja, when you listen to this now, what's the first thing that comes to your mind when you hear it yourself?
I think of my mom. I think of my grandmas. I think of all the powerful women that I was lucky to be raised around and by.
Wow. You're going to get me emotional on today's episode. It's going to happen. I've been trying all the
time.
Cry. Yes. Ya Allah. I hear you. I totally hear you. Look, towards the end, I kind of want to just say a big thank you. Seriously, it's been, for me, it's been one of those interviews or chats that I got so much enlightenment, and I don't know if I really did my job, to be honest, in terms of really portraying how you're great. But for me, it's been enlightening.
I appreciate that so much,
Wallahi,
honestly.
If it makes any sense. Seriously, I'm just honest about it, because I think usually most of the time I'm trying to get inside, you know, the human, and with you, there's so much we can, like, after all this, I feel like we're just scratching the surface. But you know, like I said, fam, Allah yahmiki, and may God really always bless you and protect you, and the family, that support system that you talk about, I think it's truly important. If you're just tuning in right now, definitely catch the full interview. But there's a lot of things that we can learn right here. For me, I learned a couple of things from you. One, which is you're never wrong when you're really, when you back up your culture. Like, you're never wrong, no matter what. This is you're a person that moved to Canada, to the West. I'm 15, right? By kind of common standard, or maybe you think that you're gonna forget your culture, because it happened to me. My cousin lives in the States, right? His name is Abdurrahman. He doesn't speak Arabic right now, for example, at all. He doesn't understand Arabic at all. He doesn't care about Arab problems, nothing. Okay, what's the... So you guys moved at the same time. So why is he like this? Because it starts with parents. Mm-hmm. You know, so this is why I go like, okay, why? Why, you know? And if parents, he didn't have the curiosity to check in with this culture, you know, that raised him. And we raised his parents. So I guess from you, for you, are you ever scared to lose that?
I mean, I learned a lot from my mom. And like you said, my mom had this rule when we first moved to Canada to only speak Arabic at home.
Ayua. Shout out, mama.
And my brother was 4 at the time. Mm-hmm. He was very young. Mm. And that rule was mostly for him, mainly for him, because my sisters and I have already mastered the language and we know how to read, write, and speak it. But that rule, honestly, as subtle and simple as it is, just speak your native language at home.
Yeah.
It had a huge impact on us. And I realized how cool it is for me to be in a country and some people don't know what I'm saying. And you can say whatever you want. No. But honestly, it helped a lot. And so if I were to... My advice for anyone in the West with children is embrace the native language. It's beautiful, and proof of resistance and existence.
That, but also as well in terms of, like, you know, I know a lot of, you know, singers and songwriters and musicians that, you know, perform in English, let's say, and they never want to portray anything Arab, and eventually they fall. Mm-hmm. They lose themselves, or they force it and they lose themselves even more. And I think, kind of full circle with you, subhanAllah, it feels with you, Saja, you didn't force anything. Everything came kind of within. You have this peace about you that's incredible within. And it's just really something to really admire. And I think it's something to be appreciated. I really, truly, truly do.
Thank you. And may I add, you also make it very, I said this to you off air, you make this space very comfortable enough for me to be comfortable and for me to express myself.
I really try. We got to go like round two, because like there's a lot of things I still have in my mind, but we're nearly we were talking obviously off air. What are the things that you wanted to do? You mentioned something about an audiobook. Can we talk a little bit about that?
Yes. So after releasing a few poems of mine, I've been getting a lot of feedback from people asking if they can hear this on a certain platform just as audio. And so I've been recently going to a studio and recording my poems.
Oh, shout out to Ammar. The process. Shout out to Ammar.
Yes. I started, recording my poems, kind of like a podcast / music, because there's music in the background as well. I'm hoping to release them on platforms like
There's
Apple
music in
music.
The background.
Yes.
Yeah, of course.
Apple Music, Spotify, and Lami, of course, and so on. And so I'm trying to create this audiobook and record poems that I've already released and ones that I haven't. Yes.
Wow. Does it have a name or not yet? No need to tell me. But
not yet. No. It's still in progress. But it is something that I've already started working on and hopefully will be releasing soon.
Like this year?
That's the goal. Yes.
What about film-wise? Like, you know, when we talk about films, are you writing anything? Are you obviously you've been part of the whole?
I've been part of a film that finished shooting in the end of January.
Okay.
And should be coming out hopefully next year.
Okay.
And
we'll definitely keep a look on that.
Yes. And I'll be part of a few short films that are coming hopefully soon.
Are you writing anything yourself?
I'm always writing. always. Nothing that I want to like work on producing soon. I think with writing, it's a it takes a few years to kind of, and a lot of consultations, and I already started writing my own film, my own feature, but it's going to have to, I'm going to give it a few more years. And in the meantime, focus on acting.
Saja Kilani, remember the name.
Thank you. I appreciate you so much.
Okay. Actually, I don't want to let go. we're past 10, you guys. But I guess for me, I want to end with this. What's any regrets that you have, like, as Saja Kilani?
No. And this might sound very cliche, but I genuinely believe in it. I don't think there's anything for one to regret. Everything is a learning process. There's a lot of things in my life, of course, that I do not like. Certain things that I've done that if I could go back, I would change for sure. But now looking back at it, everything happened. I really believe in this saying. Really genuinely, if you think about it, everything happens for a reason.
For a reason.
Everything. Good, bad. Everything.
There you are.
And so I do not regret any of that. There's a lot of things, of course, that weren't done in the way that I would be proud of. But this is life.
Yeah.
And we're humans. We make mistakes. But no, I do not believe in.
But also, there's a lot of things that you can't obviously control, right?
For sure.
So I see what you're saying as well. You see, you guys, it's one of those interviews right now. It happened maybe a couple of times where I'm not able to end. So we got to find a way. It's something I have. No, but seriously, thank you so much. Any last words you'd like to say? Like anything at all? Anybody listening in, your friends, family, anybody that, anything you'd like to say, please go ahead.
Take care of Osaka.
Oh. I'm putting it right here. Osaka, of course.
If I were to say anything to anyone,
bless you. Osaka, by the way, is a camel, and it's a gift from the incredible Saja to me.
Is honestly, be true to yourself. Do you. Don't listen to anyone. If I were to give any piece of advice, it would be that. Just listen to yourself and be truthful, be authentic.
Listen to yourself, and also if there's anything that get inspired right here, be at peace with yourself. And I think this is a journey, you know. And obviously, we try to see that journey with Saja today. But at that piece, I learned that as well. Like I need to be where you at in terms of the peace within. And it's been a long, obviously, journey for me as well from 2006 till now. So sometimes meeting people like you really kind of rejuvenates. And this is why everything happens for a reason, subhanAllah.
Exactly.
Know?
And you inspire me.
Oh, bless you. I don't know how I do that.
You like, do it.
There's no comparison. Like you're looking at a, you know, like mashallah.
It's not about that at all. It's not about that at all.
No, but seriously, I want to shout out, obviously, you know, Zen, because I got to know about you through Zen. And ever since I got to know about you, mashallah, and following kind of your journey, the way you are, you really, really inspire me in a great way. I definitely wish you all the best, fam. Seriously, you're amazing at what you do. And wow, I'm not able to end. Yo, what song can we play right now?
Honestly, I'm thinking about the legendary Fairuz.
Allah. Okay, and I can't wait right now to know, because like you can't go wrong with Fairuz, obviously. But what?
How would you like to end? Because there are multiple ways. Fairuz is.
What do you feel like now? Like which mood you in? Imagine like it's after like 10 p.m. or so. We're already past the showtime. I'm already getting calls.
Go home.
Yeah.
Honestly, Zahrat al-Madain.
Allah. Okay. That. Yep. See, can't go wrong with that.
My mom's from Jerusalem.
Oh, man. Bless. So, yeah.
This song
record.
Means a lot.
Love this song a lot. And where can people follow you?
On Instagram, Saja Kilani.
Saja Kilani. That's it. No space, no nothing, right?
Saja Kilani.
Amazing. God bless you, Saja Kilani, ladies and gentlemen. Go follow her, show her love. Incredible Palestinian, Jordanian, Canadian actress, writer, you know, a filmmaker, a poet. She has a lot of things, obviously, that she's doing, impacting a lot of people in different ways. And I think, she's incredible. And yeah, let's hear Fairuz. Have a blessed night, you guys. Take care of yourself. Saja, thank you so much
thank
for your time.
Thank you so much.
Allah yahmiki.
Appreciate you and the listeners.
Peace and love. And we say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Salam.